services of worship at the Union University Church in Alpha, New York. And to those of you who are worshiping with us by Zoom, we welcome you as well. And to those who are later worship with us on Facebook and YouTube, we welcome you. Do we have some announcements?
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good Friday, and then our resurrection. together. So we are moving forward toward Jerusalem. So now, this morning I say to you, the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Now turn to someone close to you and share the peace of Christ with them as well.
Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ, buddy.
Peace of Christ.
Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us raise our voices in joy to the rock of our salvation.
Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing unto the Lord, all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim his salvation from day to day.
Honor and majesty are before the Lord. Strength and beauty are in the Lord's sanctuary.
Let us pray together. Lord God, you are the source of all truth, wisdom, justice, and love. Lead us through this time of worship and throughout the day of service to you. Help us to rest our lives upon the eternal foundations of your love and presence. Through the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, enlighten, instruct, and guide us all our life long. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. This morning's psalm is number 139, verses 1 through 12. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. Let us join together in the singing of hymn number 408, The Gift of Love.
There are no prayer concerns written in the notebook this morning.
Not on Zoom, no.
From Zoom.
No.
Please see those in your bulletin. As we prepare for praying together this morning, I would just remind us that it's been quite a week, hasn't it? We learned this week, tragically, that the number that's been given to us is 16,221 children have been forced to leave Ukraine and enter Russia. Some have been adopted by Russian families, others are in what they call summer camp, in which they are being indoctrinated and the attempt is made to use the propaganda to turn them into Russian citizens. Because of this, Putin and one of his leaders in the government there have been charged with war crimes this week, and surely there are other charges that will follow. But we could remember to pray for those families who may or may not ever see their children again. 16,221, and they think there are far more that have not been reported. The prophet Isaiah wrote to in the final days of the earthly time of Jesus, describing Jesus in this way. He was despised and forsaken by men, people. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and like one from whom others hide their face, cannot look upon him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Let us pray together. Lord, our journey with you is growing nearer to Jerusalem and those final days before your crucifixion. These days of Lent for us have been days of reflection and repentance and prayer and preparation as we walk with you. As you were preparing yourself for the crucifixion, you were also preparing your disciples through the ages to give all of us eternal hope and assurance that in your physical absence, you have not left us. In that hope and in that assurance, we pray for a just and lasting peace in our world. We pray for the people of Ukraine who have suffered so many war crimes as they defend their freedom. We pray for those who are imprisoned unjustly because they are advocates for justice. We pray for those who are the leaders of the free world who must make decisions that affect the lives of so many. We pray for those who live and walk among us every day who have heavy hearts and struggling spirits. We pray for those in need of healing in their bodies and souls. We pray for ourselves that we may be found faithful to be your hands and feet and heart and mind in all that we do. We praise you as our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sustainer. And we pause to silently bring to you our personal prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. And hear us now as together we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples. disciples to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. printed in your bulletin. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth.
The Lord reigns. The world is established. It cannot be moved.
O you that love the Lord, hate evil. The Lord preserves the souls of his servants.
Light is sung for the righteous, and gladness for the upright.
Be glad in the Lord, you righteous, and give thanks to his holy name.
The Lord remembers his mercy and his faithfulness toward us.
As Pastor Louise has reminded us, we are halfway on our prayerful journey to Easter Sunday and the resurrection. Yet, snow is still on the ground, and although the days have lengthened to tomorrow's equinox, winter continues to surround us. Thus, we are deeply grateful this cold morning to be in the presence of God and his Son. Just as Jesus drew the hurting and forgotten to him, so he draws us to healing and raises us from death to a new life. Every day, he finds the way that we need to be loved and challenged, and then calls us to minister to others in warm hospitality, healing mercies, and the promise of resurrection and new life. In this quiet time of reflection, may we consider how best to respond to Christ's call through our gifts of resources, time, compassion, patience, and commitment, so that others may experience the love we have known in him. protection and grace, please accept the humble offering from this congregation and this blessing from the Moravian tradition. For these gifts before us and the friends among us and the love that surrounds us, we truly give you thanks. Come, Lord Jesus, bless these gifts. Bless our loved ones everywhere and keep them in your loving care. Amen. From the book of Exodus, 31, verses 1 through 11. Then the Lord said to Moses, "See, I have chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills, to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, and bronze, to cut and set stones, to work in wood, and to engage in all kinds of crafts. Moreover, I have appointed Oholiab, son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan, to help him. Also, I have given ability to all the skilled workers to make everything I have commanded you. The tent of meeting, the ark of the covenant law with the atonement cover on it, and all the other furnishings of the tent, the table and its articles, the pure gold lampstand and all its accessories, the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering and all its utensils, the basin with its stand, and also the woven garments, both the sacred garments for Aaron the priest and the garments for his sons when they serve as priests, and the anointing oil and fragrant incense for the holy place. They are to make them just as I commanded you." Our New Testament reading is from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Romans during a truly treacherous time in the city of Rome. People worshipped in their houses secretly. Chapter 12, verses 1 to 13. "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That fits with the theme of the Holy Spirit. The chorus says, like a tender breath stirring, your word breathing in us like a potter's clay vessel, your love making and shaping.
Thank you.
now been 6 months since Moses led the Hebrews out of Egypt into liberty. They have stopped at Mount Sinai, and he has received the commandments. And now God comes to speak to him for the sixth time, and he tells him that it is time to build a tent of meeting, a tabernacle, where God can meet these people in worship. Moses is learning in all of the learning of Egypt. He lived there for so many years, even in the house of Pharaoh. But Moses has no ability to build a tabernacle. He has no construction ability at all. These refugees that he has brought with him out of Egypt know how to make bricks with mud. They know how to work in clay. But how is he going to build something great for God that includes gold and cutting of precious stones when all he has to work with are bricklayers and masons? There will be more than enough people to do the work, but someone has to oversee it. Someone has to be in charge. God takes care of that matter also, and he identifies persons who will oversee the building of the tabernacle. Zadok from the tribe of Judah will be the architect for this project. He was at the time, at the same time, commissioned by Moses to work with Aaron and to be the guide for the people in the absence of Moses while he was up on the mountain. So he already has a position of leadership. Aholiab from the tribe of Dan will be his assistant, his helper. Dan is one of those lesser tribes, one of those smaller tribes, and so it doesn't have such great standing among the people, but his standing is certainly going to be elevated because Aholiab has been chosen to help with this wonderful project. The person whom God calls to service, the person whom God calls to any kind of ministry, God equips. And God qualifies these two people to be the leaders in this project. He says to Moses, I have filled him. I have filled Bezalel with the Spirit of God. And in the hearts of all that are wise-hearted, and all of these people that you have surrounded you here, I have put my wisdom. It is recorded in the scripture that the same Holy Spirit gave the workers the wisdom about how to work gold and silver and work in and animal skins. The Holy Spirit enables them with some practical skills. They will build a place where God can just as their sacrifices and their prayers will be. The Hebrews have benefited from God's redemption from slavery, and now they will participate with God in creation and in artistry, for they will be building a human place that will become holy. Move now to our reading from the New Testament. Paul is a Hebrew of the Hebrews, a follower of Jesus, and he writes to the Christians who are living in Rome and to us of all generations about God's parallel teachings to us. Just as Moses first called the people of the Hebrews to be in covenant with God, Paul comes to call us as followers of Jesus Christ to present ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy unto the Lord, which he said is your proper, your reasonable service. Of course that's what you'd do if you were a Christian, he says. We're first to give ourselves totally to Christ. Paul says to those Christians who were living in a society where it was anything but Christian, those people living in Rome, be who you say you are. And having urged and encouraged the readers of his letter about their responsibilities, he begins to describe this new group in a different way because they have now become the church, a group that he refers to as the body of Christ. He needs to tell them about the spiritual gifts that have been made possible by the Holy Spirit that resides within them. The teachings can be very practical. Paul begins his teachings by comparing the body of Christ, the church, to the human body. And he says to them, you know there are many parts to your human body, and all of them have an important function. Did you ever have a sore toe? What does it do to the rest of your body? You limp along, you hurt all over. Paul is saying to them, he is reminding them that every part of the body is important. It's important for every part of the body to be healthy. It's important for every part of the body to be functioning. And then he gets really personal. It's important for the body of Christ to function in the same way. When Paul talks about the spiritual gifts that have been given to each follower of Jesus Christ and how each of those gifts is so important, he doesn't hesitate to begin to outline what they might be. Let me hasten to say that there are several places in our scriptures that refer to different kinds of gifts, and this is just one place that I've chosen to focus on this morning. But there are many, many, many gifts that are listed in various places. But let me just dwell upon those that Paul talks about in this particular place. He talks about prophecy. He's not talking about Isaiah. Prophecy for him says it's the ability to proclaim and to apply God's truth so that believers can be encouraged and consoled and non-believers can be told about how to follow Christ. He talks about faith. How believing that God will act when everything looks as though it will be to the contrary. He talks about the gift of service, helping others with their ministries like Aholiab did in that scripture we read earlier. He talks about teaching, the ability to explain the scriptures and the Christian life in a clear way that helps people with their practical daily living. He talks about encouragement, the ability to motivate people through encouragement to accomplish those things that will enrich their lives and will honor God. He talks about giving, the ability to give cheerfully, not out of oftness, but because we want to, the ability to give both of our financial means and our personal resources. He talks about leadership, that ability with caring concern to inspire and motivate others so that together we all as a group accomplish our goals. And he talks about hospitality, the ability to make everybody feel welcome. We experience some other gifts that he doesn't mention in this particular place. Every time we come to worship, consider all of the music ministry that we have. These people can play instruments anywhere. These people can sing anywhere. We would come and we would applaud and we would pay to see and hear them. But when they come here, there is something about what they do that enables us to worship. That's a gift by God. And while we're ministering with our gifts that have been placed into our lives, we are to do it with joy. We are to do it with hope. We're to do it with patience, even when times are difficult. And we're to do it with much prayer. Most of us have been given many gifts, multiple abilities for ministry and the life of the church. Each of those gifts has been given by the presence of the Holy Spirit. And so if you deny you have gifts, you are denying what Jesus told you. Because he said, when I go, I will send my Spirit. And each of us has a God-given responsibility to use what God has given to us. It's interesting. I remember when Martin Luther King said, whatever you do, do it to the glory of God. If you're sweeping streets, if you're shoveling snow, do it to the glory of God. And so I hear people say, well, I don't know what my spiritual gifts are. Sometimes others can see them in us more clearly than we can see them in ourselves. But here are some hints. What you do will give you joy in doing it. What you do will be effective, or else it will become more effective with some training. And others will see what you do and realize that it is well done. It's been my experience over many years that within every congregation there exist all of the spiritual gifts that are necessary to do all of the ministry that that congregation is called to do. One more thing. It isn't a matter of age. It's a matter of being a follower of Jesus Christ and being part of the body of Christ, the church. Being a follower of Jesus and being gifted, you're never too young and you're never too old. One of the greatest gifts that a child or a youth might have is that caring concern about your peer group. And when life is tough, you stand with them. One of the greatest gifts that even those who are aged and infirm might have is that gift of intercessory prayer for others. You don't have to leave your home to pray, you know. I'm just saying,
When it comes time to fill out those stewardship pledge cards about the area of service that you'll be interested in for the coming year, I want you to think about that spiritual gift or those gifts that God has given to you. It's not, oh, I guess I ought to volunteer. It's no, God has gifted me. I have a spiritual gift to do these kinds of things that are required by this group of people. Sign me up. And never, ever, ever, ever let me or anyone else hear you say, I've done my time. Let someone else do it. You know, when you've done your time, God will take you home, and then you can rest. So as we move forward and as we prepare for the future, will you diligently, purposely pray about what God has gifted you to do and what it is in the ministry of this body of Christ that God is calling you to do as your reasonable service to God and from this place into the world. Amen. Now, as we prepare to sing our last hymn, I've given you that thought I want you to think about. What will be your response as you pray about it and as you commit yourselves as a living sacrifice to God, which is your reasonable service? Amen.
Thank you.
As you sang those words, I hope that might become truly your friend. Let us receive the benediction. Lord, we go from this place into the world to be your people, your presence. Guide us through these days that we might be all